We have an interesting program, I think, and you're all here and ready, so I don't like to waste any time. Before beginning, I want to introduce Mr. Chen's wife, partner, and advisor, participant. She's a universal woman, Miss Yuan Weijing. Please stand up. Mr. Chen is deluged with awards, recognitions of all kinds. But Yuan Weijing should be recognized in all of them. I also want to introduce my distinguished new colleague, Ira Belkin. He, in his life, embodies the interaction of China, Chinese law, and the United States. He's an 82 graduate of this school, JD. He was a prosecutor in the federal system for 16 years. Before that, he was a teacher of Chinese at Middlebury College, which is really unbelievable. And then he decided wisely to combine his interest in China with his interest in law. He spent 4 years as legal advisor at the American Embassy in Beijing, gave him extensive contact with both academe and government and reality in China. And then the last 5 years, he's been the Ford Foundation's legal expert on China in Beijing. So he's just joined us. He's executive director of our U.S. Asia Law Institute. And I thought this was a wonderful occasion to ask him to join the conversation with my dear friend, Mr. Chen. I've already told Mr. Chen what I'm going to say, so don't worry. We're not keeping him in the dark. I think we couldn't have a more appropriate time for this meeting. Some of you know today is known in the Chinese world as Double Ten, the 10th day of the 10th month. It's the date of the establishment of the Republic of China that just over 100 years ago replaced the millennial Chinese imperial dynasties. The problems they faced then are almost identical to the problems that China confronts today and tomorrow. How do you govern a huge country with a highly specific Confucian Buddhist tradition that never went through the experiences of the Western world that have done so much to shape our own legal system? The 18th Party Congress that will convene on November 8th in Beijing faces historic choices. What is China going to do? We in the outside world read about China's phenomenal economic and even social progress. But the leaders of China and many of the people there know full well the challenges that China confronts. And the legal system is one of the major challenges that the government now is increasingly open about recognizing. Just yesterday, the Chinese government issued a white paper on judicial reform, recognizing that the Chinese system has thus far failed to meet the increasing demands of the Chinese people for social justice and equal justice and fair and independent tribunals. They have to chart a course. It's easy to say we won't blindly copy the West, but what will they do? They obviously want to continue to cooperate with the West, NYU Law School, our U.S. Asia Law Institute. That's why we got Ira Belkin here. We do a lot of cooperation to help, you might say, improve the legal system wholesale. But we also confront the problem of what do we do about retail, individual cases. Chinese law reformers, most of them are scholars. In China, law professors play a more important role in their society with regard to law reform than we play in ours. But Chinese law professors have been very slow to speak out about individual cases. And yet, as you know from reading the papers, we're confronted by a steady stream of individual cases, of wrongful convictions, of political injustice, of blatant oppression. And the problem is, what can we do about it? Chinese law professors tend to take the long view, let's work on reforming the law. We'll worry about practice some other time. It's not convenient now. Well, they are improving their laws. January 1st, a new criminal procedure law will go into effect for 1.3 billion people. But will it really go into effect? Will the police and the prosecutors and the party figures involved pay attention to it? Practice is crucial. And we all have responsibility, not only Chinese, but foreigners, to think about what, if anything, can we do about it? What should we be doing about it? And that's how Mr. Chen got here. I met him in New York 9 years ago. I was very impressed. He was already well known. That's why the State Department gave him the International Visitors Grant that brought his wife and him to New York. And we became friends, and in China, I went down to his native village. You couldn't find a poorer place. And he introduced me for a whole rainy Saturday to an array of his so-called clients. He was a barefoot lawyer, a product only of self-study, trying to help the impoverished people, especially people with disabilities, somehow to get relief through the governmental and legal system. Unfortunately, 2 years later, that led to a series of collisions with the Chinese government from which he now has happily emerged. So that's the background, that's the context. And you see, New York University is involved in this, and everyone in this room is involved in this. And there are some people in this room, I think, who stayed away because they're from China, and I know they don't want to be identified as being involved in any way with this controversial figure because they are not free. The most objectionable thing I have about the Chinese system is it's not only repressing its own people, but it's extending its reach into our society, trying to stop our freedoms from being exercised. And I think at some points, one has to draw the line. Well, enough of the introduction. Shen zai guangcheng wei jing ge ta men jie shao at Beijing. Ge zhi shen zai wo ti ge wen ti. I'm going to ask him the first question, which is he's already been here almost 5 months, over 4 months. And what does he think about all this? Recently, I went to hear the famous dissident writer Liao Yiwu, now exiled in Germany, after he came to the U.S. for 4 days. And somebody in the audience said, what do you think about America? And he said, I don't know anything about America. I just got here and I've spent all 4 days in Flushing. So the next question was, what do you think about Flushing? He said, ah, that's easy. He said, Flushing is China without communism. So,你的影响怎么样?你干什么?你做什么?为什么你来这里?
怎么说呢?首先非常感谢纽约大学以及纽约大学法学院 邀请我过来给我这个机会，我在这儿呢，主要是在研究这有机会呢研究这个法律问题、法治问题。总的来说呢，就是为这个中国必须变化的明天做准备。 First of all, I want to thank New York University and the law school for giving me the opportunity to come here. I came here to study questions about the rule of law and legal questions and to prepare for China's tomorrow.
中国目前的状况呢，大家都有目共睹。历史走到今天，已经到了非转型不可的时刻，所以我们应该为转型以后的中国社会做更多准备。每一个人都有这样的义务。
In China, we have come to the point where change is already inevitable, and so it's our responsibility to prepare for that change.
好的。
So, 具体说你在这里干什么？怎么使用你的机会来这里？
So, what are you actually doing here?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Thank you.
怎么说呢？这个应该说，我是从事维权呢，首先是从残疾人的基本权利开始的。 那么我现在呢，也在纽约大学呢，也在研究这个有关残疾人的法律，像美国的ADA法案和中国的残疾保障法有多大区别，还有呢，就是说，在美国的这些刑诉法和中国的刑诉法之间有什么区别？美国的这些社会的法律是靠什么力量？ 来真正兑现它维护社会公正的这样的作用的，还有就是像国际法应该对这些不开放的国家起到的，应该起到哪些更重要的作用等等，这一些工作这都是我在做的。同时，我也在哦，不好意思。
So I started out studying how to protect people's rights, and I started with protecting the rights of people with disabilities. So I've been studying the Americans with Disabilities Act and comparing that to the Chinese law on persons with disabilities. And I've been studying American criminal procedure law and comparing that with the Chinese criminal procedure law. And I'm trying to understand what is it about American society and the power of American society that protects people's rights to seek justice. And I'm also interested in international law and how international law can play a role in helping people seek justice.
数年的经历呢，也怎么说呢？我也应该让更多的人了解，通过这些经历来了解中国社会，特别是农村的实际生活状况，以及法律在中国农村所起的作用，还有就是美国的宪法和中国的宪法究竟根本的不同在哪里？
So I also feel that I want to share my many years' experience and let people know what it's like in the Chinese countryside, particularly the countryside. I'm also studying the American Constitution and comparing it to the Chinese Constitution.
我非常珍惜这次学习机会，因为在中国残疾人受教育的机会是非常不容易的。
I especially treasure this opportunity because in China, it's very, very difficult for people with disabilities to have the opportunity to study.
好的，谢谢。
Thank you.
I want to know whether any blind man or woman has ever studied law in China.
我想知道在中国有没有任何盲人，不管是男的女的，学过法律。
如果说学过法律的话，我想是应该是。 要看什么形式了。如果说科班的到司法学校里去学习法律的，我目前还没有听说。那么如果说自己为了自己的使用，为了我以后自己的权利去学一些法律的，这样的人是有的。So
I guess it depends on your definition of study. If you mean to formally study in a law school, I haven't heard of anyone. But if you mean self-study to learn the law for yourself so you can protect your rights, there are some people.
其实我学习法律也是在我的真正专业是学的中医，因为没有其他的选择，盲人如果读大学就只有学中医一条路。
Actually, what I studied was traditional Chinese medicine, Because for people with disabilities, the only path in school is to study traditional Chinese medicine.
所以我的法律也是选修的。
So when I started studying law, that was an optional class for me.
当然在此之前有过自学。
And before that, I studied law on my own.
China has some very good do-it-yourself law books. If you go into a Chinese bookstore, you can find a number of pamphlet-sized books that explain civil procedure, taxation, even the rights of disabled people. And in 2003, I went into the New China bookstores with Mr. Chen and bought him $100 worth of books. And when I went down a month later to the village, they were well-fingered because his wife had read those books to him, and his oldest brother, who's still back in the village, had read to him and sometimes even went to court.
One book changed the whole village.
So, Shenzai, 你学习英文吗? I'm asking about English.
对，我要了解更多国际的一些法律，这个英美法系的一些在社会起的作用，跟英文是分不开的。当然，我现在也在语言障碍不排除的话，可能很难让我深入，所以我在努力学习英文。
Yes, I want to learn more about international law and American law, and language is an obstacle to that, so I want to work hard and learn English.
你可以给我们介绍你的孙子这个陈科贵的案件。 I've asked him about his nephew's problem. His nephew has made Mr. Chen feel very guilty because 4 days after he fled from their village, the police discovered his departure and then took it out on his oldest brother and the brother's wife and the 26-year-old son, his nephew. And about 30 of them beat up the family and took away the father, and the nephew got a kitchen knife and tried to defend the family. And I want him to explain that.
你可以给他们介绍这个案件的事实也现在的情况。可以，可以。这个有大家知道，我长期被非法拘禁在家。那么我有机会离开山东以后呢，这个当地的这个当权者呢就恼羞成怒，由地方分管政法的副书记带着一群暴徒半夜翻墙闯入我大哥家，实施打砸抢。
So as many of you know, I was under illegal house arrest for many months. And when I had the opportunity to leave Shandong, my home, after that, several government officials, including a deputy party secretary, entered my brother's home in the middle of the night and started beating my brother and his wife.
这个行动没有任何的法律手续，没有任何人去穿制服。 他们只是通过这种土匪的手段半夜翻墙入宅，然后抢走家里的通讯工具、电话册以及等等一宗物品，然后对我大哥失手殴打，并把他抓走。So
without any legal process, they entered my brother's home and took away what they could carry, communications devices, and beat my brother.
可以继续。好。
在这种情况下呢，就是说，在把我大哥抓走以后，他们这帮暴徒在一个小时内有两次返回到他家里，对我的大嫂还有我的侄子陈可贵，用这种洋镐把进行殴打。So
they took my brother away and brought him back a couple of times, and then they came back and attacked my aunt and my sister-in-law and my nephew, and they took a stick and beat them.
即使在这种情况下，我的侄子如果不还手，就被他们打死的情况下，因为后来我侄子的脸上、脖子上都有非常严重的伤，3个小时还在流血。
At this point, if my nephew didn't fight back, he might have been beaten to death because my nephew ended up with various serious injuries on his face and his neck. He was bleeding for 3 hours.
他们有30几个人都拿着木棍。
There were over 30 people carrying wooden sticks.
陈可贵如果再不还手，很有可能就会被他们打死，因为他们用来有一次他们举起棍子照着陈可贵的头打下去，陈可贵躲开以后，他的棍子把电视机打得粉碎。
If Chen Kegui didn't fight back, he might have been beaten to death because at one point someone tried to hit him with a stick and missed him. He got out of the way and they smashed the television set to bits.
棍子也被打折了，所以在这种情况下，陈可贵就拿起菜刀来抵挡他们，保护自己。那么划伤了三个攻击他的人，结果就被指控为故意杀人抓了起来。
So he grabbed a knife to protect himself, and he stabbed three of the people who were attacking him, and then he was arrested on charges of intentional murder, or intentionally causing serious bodily injury.
It's very hard to translate the charge as we've got it. Nobody died. As far as we know, nobody was seriously hurt, but one of them was the leader of the township that controlled the village. And he walked away bleeding, but we've never heard that anybody suffered any serious harm. But we've never heard of anything, which is the point of we're getting to.
我给他们介绍这个科奎的自己的损失，也他没有杀死人。对，可是我们还不知道没有消息。对，现在呢，就是说到现在已经从5月份就被抓起来，到现在已经是5个多月了吧，没有任何的消息，连律师也不能见到他。肯定的是，一开始他被受到严重的酷刑虐待。
So this all happened in May. It's now been over 5 months, and we've had no news. In fact, even his lawyers have not been able to see him. So we suspect that he must have been treated very harshly and tortured, and that's why no one's been able to see him.
所以像这样的情况，可能跟大家所了解到的中国的法治状况相差甚远，但这就是 占80%-90%的中国农村的实际状况，跟大家知道的北京、上海很不一样。
So this may sound like a situation that's very, very far from what people think about the rule of law in China. The gap between the rule of law and a situation like this is very great. But this is what life is like for a large portion of the population. It's not like life for people in big cities like Shanghai or Beijing.
这里呢有一点非常重要，我要强调，就是说，中国的法律规定的非常清楚，入室抢劫，按照中国的刑法是10年以上有期徒刑，但是共产党的干部入室打砸抢就可以不被法律追究，这就是现实。
So the Chinese laws are actually quite clear. If you commit a burglary and enter someone's home without permission, you could be sentenced to up to 10 years. But in this case, when party officials entered a home, they received no punishment.
而且是在世界瞩目之下。
And this was before the eyes of the world.
我还是想回去律师的问题。你可以给他们详细的说明，你们委派的律师没有办法。对。可是政府委派的律师。对。
I'm
asking him to elaborate a little more on the lawyer problem, because he said our lawyers haven't been able to see his nephew. But it's a little more complicated than that, so I'm asking him to spell out the government has appointed lawyers who he doesn't want. In fact, he was formally represented by the same law firm when he was convicted in 2006, and they were worthless.
我们请的律师去过多次，都以各种理由借口不让陈可贵和他的律师见面。后来，当地政府就强行为陈可贵指派了2位所谓的法律援助律师。
The lawyers we hired for him tried to see him many times, but were never allowed to see him. And then the local officials appointed so-called legal aid lawyers to represent him.
但是他们虽然说是陈可贵自己请的, 但是没有任何陈可贵的这个书面授权。
So, and although they say these legal aid lawyers were hired by Chen Kegui, there's no written authorization to retain these lawyers by Chen Kegui.
所以这个经历跟我06年的经历很相似, 他们指派的律师只是在法庭上说, 对任何的指控都会说没有异议, 而不为当事人辩护, 也不去查证事实。
So this experience is very similar to my own experience in 2006, when the lawyers that were assigned to me didn't put up any defense, didn't do any investigation, and didn't really represent me.
我们公开地要求这两位律师退出，这两位律师说，如果他们自己退出的话，政府就会拿掉他的饭碗。
They demanded that these lawyers recuse themselves from the case, and the lawyers said that the government threatened that if they did not withdraw from the case, they would take away their license and they would have no means of livelihood.
我们的律师到现在也是完全没有办法跟陈可贵接触，这个案子已经超出了中国法律的刑事诉讽法的这个程序，因为如果他要延长侦查的话，他需要经检察院批准。 据我们了解，没有这样的延长手续。
So, our lawyers have no way to see Chen Kegui, and under Chinese law, they've already exceeded the period of time for which he could be lawfully held without being charged. And under our understanding of the law, there's really no basis for extending that time period.
Well, that's the question. 我们应该研究这个问题，因为 we have to study this problem because China's criminal procedure law is full of exceptions. It's full of provisions for unusual circumstances. And it's not transparent. So behind the scenes, they may well have pursued certain procedures to extend the time for holding him before they have to decide will they prosecute him, indict him, or not. 我给他们介绍，这个刑诉法有很多例外，有很多不太清楚的条款。所以，我们不知道，因为没有透明度，实际上这个警察做什么。So the time can't go on forever unless they get the National People's Congress Standing Committee to give a special dispensation. But otherwise, they'll have to come to the point. Even in the case of Wu Xilai's wife, Gu Kailai, they had to move ahead and prosecute her. And Wang Lijun, the police chief whose defection led to the exposure of the Bo case, they had to move ahead. They'll have to move ahead with Chen Kegui, but we don't know when. They may not have agreed on what to do with him, and they may be holding him as a kind of hostage for Mr. Chen's good behavior. 我给他们介绍，我们不知道他们有什么原因，为什么不解决可贵的问题，不决定起诉不起诉。甚至薄熙来的太太跟这个王立军，他们都应该决定起诉。所以有一天应该决定，可是到目前为止我们不知道。So, Ira, please.
Okay, I'd like to ask a question. And I'll change the topic a little bit. I want to go back to Mr. Chen's early career when you began studying the law. And one thing I've observed over a long period of time is that although many people see a gap between the law as it's written in China and the law in practice, you have always had a determination that the law in China should be enforced and should be followed. And that seems to be a principle that you followed since you started studying the law. And I want to ask you if that, first, is that the case? And second, if that is the case, where does that come from? How did you develop faith in the law and the rule of law? So, 我想回到你最早的开始自学法律的时候，你从那个时候开始好像对法律有一定的期望，而且有一定的信仰，是认为这个虽然 纸上的法律跟实践的法律是有很大的差异，但是你对
法律还是有期望，还是觉得还是坚持认为所有的人包括政府官员应该遵守法律，第一个问题就你是不是这样想，第二个问题是你这个信仰，你这个对法律的信心，它的来源是什么，你为什么对法律怎么有信心。
我觉得法律本身它应该就成为一个社会的公器，就像一个尺子一样，不管是谁，是他是一个国家的领导也好，一个普通的民众也好，他拿起这个尺子来衡量一个东西的长度的时候都不会有改变，不管是用来量什么，它的长度都是固定的。法律应该成为这样一个工具。
I feel that the law should be a tool for society. It's like a ruler, and it doesn't matter whether the ruler is used by a leader of the country or just an ordinary citizen. It should measure the same distance. And I've always felt that that's the way that the law should work. It's just a tool of society.
而且中国的当权者也是这样承诺的，但问题是现在的事实是法律只对一部分人起作用，而对另一部分人不起作用。
And the leaders of the country also say the same thing, and they say that they believe the same thing. But in reality, the law is only being put to use by certain segments of society, and for other segments of society, the law is not useful.
社会如果没有这个，没有一个法治供大家可以遵循的话，那么就等于整个社会没有一个大家可循的尺度去做事情，也就没有一个最基本的信用。
If a society doesn't have a fundamental rule of law, then there's no guidelines to follow. That society doesn't know what the rules are and what they should follow.
那就会进入到一种弱肉强食的丛林原则当中。
弱肉强食。
对，谁弱，谁弱谁就是肉，谁强谁就可以吃它。
Okay. And in that case, society would just turn into a dog-eat-dog world. Like, and have some license. Some people will just turn into the prey, and some people will turn into those who pursue the prey.
说到我学习法律呢，这个时间是跨越比较久的。我看到一些法律以后，政府说的也很好，我就要用实际行动要求政府按照他们说的，按照他们法律规定的去兑现，去落实。
So, after many years of studying the law, I saw that there were many laws that I thought the government should follow. And so I said, you know, here's the law, and you government officials should follow the law.
但是我从最低的地方政府一直到北京的中央政府，我都通过上访的形式跟他们打过交道，我发现他们是说一套做一套，根本不去实现自己的诺言。
And I talked to government officials from the lowest level, local officials, all the way to the central government. I used the petitioning system in China to present this to Chinese government officials. But I found that many of them say one thing and do another thing.
最后我觉得呢，法律是有一个强制力的，而且当权者也说司法是独立的。我想我们应该学习法律，让法院的强制力来保证我们的权利。
At last I saw that the law is powerful, and even government officials say that the court should act independently to enforce the law.
所以那个时候我就学习一些法律知识，然后跟一些残疾人朋友一起到法院起诉。这里还有一个因素，就是当地政府不给你兑现法律的承诺，当地的律师不敢接手这样的案子，因为这样的案子都是政府侵权，要做行政诉讼，找当地的律师，普通的民众没有钱，律师不愿代理，当然代理行政案子也会得罪政府。
So at that time, early on when I was studying about the law governing people with disabilities, I saw that in the local areas, a lot of lawyers refused to take these kind of cases. Because in these kind of cases, the plaintiffs would be challenging the actions of the government, saying that the government had violated the rights of people with disabilities. And ordinary lawyers didn't want to take these cases. So it was really left to me and some of my other friends who were also disabled
to go to court and bring these cases.
所以呢，我们就只好自己学习法律，自己运用法律武器，自己到法院去跟法院打交道，进行诉讼，维护自身权利。
自力更生。
是，自力更生。
So it was left to us to use the law as a weapon, to go to court and to engage with court officials and to bring cases and to protect our rights. And as Jerry said, to change our lives.
到现在呢，我们发现其实这些法律法院也好，检察院也好，公安也好，都要按照政法委的意志来工作，所以我现在觉得中国有法律没有法治。
So I've seen that it doesn't matter whether it's the courts, the prosecutors or the police, they all take direction from the Communist Party Political Legal Committee. And soIn China, we have laws, but we don't have the rule of law.
一个没有规则的社会会稳定吗？所以中国必须有宪政法治。
So I ask, can a country with no laws have stability? I think China must have the rule of law.
This is not a new question in East Asia, of course. In the 60s and 70s,American policy confronted this in South Korea with the dictatorship of Park. We confronted it for many decades in Taiwan with the dictatorship of Chiang Kai-shek. But we have seen in both those countries, beginning the late 1980s, dramatic change, not only in a democratic system, but in a legal system.So some people hope that in China, the examples of these countries, which are of course far smaller, far less successful perhaps, but far easier to govern than a huge population, but nevertheless worthy of study. 我给他们介绍不是第一次我们美国政府碰到这样的政策问题。这个韩国七十年代这个蒋介石的蒋介石的这个台湾的六十年代、七十年代一样的问题，
是是
这个政府要用压力，或者要给这个社会压力，用政法系统。
对，八十年代的台湾就是现在的中国，现在的台湾就是明天的中国。
So yes, you're right. The 1980s Korea is.China today and
Taiwan.
It's China. All right, kind of zoned out there for a minute. Sorry. Sexually dead, ma.
Ah. 我说，哦，八十年代的台湾就是现代的中国。
The 1980s Taiwan is the China of today.
今天的中国啊，今天的台湾就是明天的中国。
And,
大陆哈，明天的中国大陆。
And the Taiwan of today is the China of tomorrow.
Well, now you have a chance to ask questions, make comments, whatever. And I've been to this forum before, and I know how lively it can be. So I hope you'll take advantage of the opportunity. And we'll do the best we can to deal with the difficult translation problems.My first problem is my hearing isn't very good, so please speak loud and use the microphones. Yeah, we have microphones here.
And as a non-professional interpreter, I would ask you to keep your questions short and use simple language.
And you don't have to identify yourself.Were you first, or? Oh, she's working here. I see.
Thank you. My name is Zhou Chen from Shanghai, China, and I'm studying in Fordham University Law School. My question is because I'm also very interested in, I think, make the law go further in China, and I want to know. The question is to both of you three, and how to study how to make law in the state. I mean, is a classes in law school? What class of can we study to start to learn how to make law?
Because well, it sounds like you're looking for some career advice.
Yeah, because I think it's bothering me very much because I don't know how.
Yeah, I'll be glad to talk to you privately.
Privately?
But okay. Do you have a comment or question for our visitor here?
Because I think this is also a problem for many of our Chinese students. Because I think when we study in law school, the purpose is not only to be a lawyer. We need to make the law, I mean, go further. So I think this question is relevant.
Okay, 你可以翻译好吧?
我翻，用你会中文吧。 大家好，我叫陈哲，来自于上海，是现在在福德汉姆大学法学院读书。然后我的问题是，我们在美国应该。通过怎么样一些哪些课程，还有哪些方法可以学到如何去立法？然后我认为这个问题对现在中国对中国的学生，特别是法学院的学生是非常重要的，因为我们学习法律不仅仅是做律师，更重要的是推动法治的进程。谢谢。我不知道你可以不可以这个答复，你有自己的看法。当然可以，这个。
我觉得立法其实很多尝试就可以解释，立法最基本的就是要维护一个公正的原则，维护大多数人的利益，这个基本原则是没问题的。其实中国的当权者他也非常清楚，有这样的法律的时候，恰恰他是要阻止这样的法律出台。比如说，中国律师协会，我们都知道中国的选举。 当权者会说，农村的人口这个文化素质不够高，导致这个不能直选。那么律师协会文化素质够不够高？为什么不让他直接选举律师协会？所以立法问题，我觉得，我们应该考虑到中国的一大半法律都是，要翻译吗？好。
I feel that when talking about legislation, we know that there are, the point of legislation is to protect the principle of justice. But in China, a lot of government officials try to prevent these kinds of laws from being passed. I'll give you an example. In the All China Lawyers Association, there was an attempt to have free elections of officers. And sometimes when we bring up the subject of elections, Chinese officials say, well, we can't have elections in the countryside because people there are not well educated and they don't really know enough to participate in elections. But even when it comes to a bar association, elections are not permitted.
长话短说吧，中国目前的立法，我觉得应该从这么一个方面：第一，完善良法；第二，去除恶法。
To make a long story short, I would say, improve the good laws, or perfect the good laws, and get rid of the bad laws.
Yes, please.
Mr. Chen, thank you so much for being here today. It's a great pleasure. Now that you're here in the States, I'm hoping you could speak a little bit about how you envision your continuing role affecting change in China. It's been said that it's very difficult for critics of the government or dissidents to continue to remain relevant once they have left. And I'm hoping you can tell us what you hope to get out of your upcoming trip to Taiwan.
非常感谢，陈老师这个来跟我们这个对话。我想问你现在在美国，你想如何在中国推动法治起作用？因为我们知道很多批评中国的中国人出来以后，很容易被边缘化。
很难起作用，所以我想知道你的计划是什么。好，第二，我还想知道你未来去台湾是想去台湾做什么。我想我对中国做什么，这不是仅仅是我一个人能够决定的事情，很多人在法治、在社会文明问题上都有责任，是没有国界的一个话题。
In terms of what I'm able to do, that will not be decided just by me. There are many people who have a responsibility inside and outside China to promote the rule of law.
我想能够对中国做什么渠道很多呀，我从来不认为在任何一种环境中是不能做事情的，即使在监狱里，只要你想做事，只要你想办法去做事，也还可以做事。
As to what I can do, I think there are many paths to making a difference. I've always felt that no matter where I am, no matter what environment I'm in, I'm always able to do something. Even when I was in prison, I felt that I could make a difference.
台湾的这个，我去台湾呢，这个是这个台湾目前的现实状况有很多这个值得中国大陆借鉴的东西。我想中国大陆的转型或者说改变是不可避免的。那么台湾的经验是非常重要的，所以我去台湾可能更多的除了了解中国文化在台湾保存的状况。
I think there's a lot to learn from Taiwan. As I said, I think change in China is inevitable, and the Taiwan experience is very important for us. There's a lot that we can learn from Taiwan. I would like to go to Taiwan and learn about how the Chinese culture has been preserved in Taiwan. I'd also like to learn more about Taiwan's democracy and rule of law.
And of course, we have quite a few people from Taiwan here every year, not only as students, but also as visiting scholars, experts, lawyers, prosecutors, judges. And here I want to put in a commercial for the U.S. Asia Law Institute, because we have programs that bring these people together. And I'm glad to see my distinguished colleague in the back, Professor Frank Upham, who has spent a lot of time in Taiwan as well as in China and Japan. So, 我给他们介绍，除了去台湾了解情况以外，在这里也可以了解台湾的情况。我们有很多台湾来的专家，不只是研究生、这个留学生，还有律师、这个法官。
这个检察官其他的，对，交流很重要。Exchange
is very important.
对，信息，所以独裁者也意识到这一点，极力的封锁互联网。And
dictators also realize that information is very valuable, and some of them try to stop the internet.
So 现在有其他的问题, I think you've been waiting, and then we'll ask you, please. Go ahead.
I want to thank you all today for being here. Mr. Chen, it's a great honor to be in the same room with you. I think we've all followed your journey here, and it's really incredible. So my question is, given that right now in China, the wealthiest people, the most powerful people, the entire system of government, and to some degree, a lot of like the arguably positive economic change that has happened throughout the country is based on, to some degree, the lack of a rule of law. A lot of people would not have gotten rich, and so a lot of this economic change may not have happened if there was more of a rule of law. Why do you think that these people in power will allow this change to happen? And if you'll pardon me, I'm going to try to ask this question in Chinese. Chen 先生，我非常感谢你来到这里。我们都非常佩服你，知道，就是通过你，我们都知道一个人的勇敢能得到一个更好的明天。那我的问题是，你为什么相信，如果现在中国的最有权力的人，那个政府人、商家， 如果他们因为这个权利，他们发财了，而且因为这个权利就是凭着现在中国是一个人者，不是一个法者，他们为什么会允许中国变成一个法者？如果他们因为这个人者就发财了，因为这个因为是一个人者，你们的那个经济就发展了这么多，为什么他们会允许这个变化？你的中文很棒，谢谢。
Are you a law student?
I am a law student. I'm a first-year law student. I used to be a translator.
Come around sometime
soon. Okay.
I didn't completely understand the question. But I'll answer the part that I understood.
Okay.
首先呢，中国的经济实际的状况，我认为并不是很了解的，并不是很多。嗯嗯，就是说，我认为外界啊，对中国的实际经济状况了解的并不是很多。
I don't have that much understanding of China's economic situation.
单纯的从数字上来讲呢，这个好像是民众的收入提高了。Just
looking at the numbers, it seems that the standard of living of ordinary people has gone up.
但是购买力我并不认为是提高了，因为以前，比如说以前的猪肉是一块钱一斤，现在的猪肉是十五块钱一斤。那么你要单纯算数字的话，算GDP的话，数字是增大了，但是老百姓购买力并没有提高。So
if you look at numbers, the standard of living seems to have gone up, but the purchasing power really hasn't gone up. It used to be only 1 yuan for 1 jin of work, and now it's 15 yuan. And so you can't just look at the GDP.
所以呢，我觉得对于占百分之八九十的农民的生活状况呢，大家了解的并不多，这是一个误解。So
as far as life for a large portion of the population, 80% of China who are peasants, people don't really understand very much.
当权者赚了很多钱，这是不错。 但是他们是靠自己的特权拿到这个社会的资源，而不是说靠合法经营、诚实劳动获得。
It's true those in power have made a lot of money, but often they're relying on the abuse of their power to make money, not actually on legitimate legal business activity.
如果有人可以随便把所有老百姓的钱拿来做一件事情的话，我想可能财力上是很丰厚的。
If an official can take the money that belongs to everyone and do what they want with it, of course, they can make a lot of money.
可能大家看到的就是因为这个原因所造成的一种现象。现在很多人要提问。 Oh, okay.
Okay.
So, okay. Maybe. Thank you very much, Guangcheng. It's your turn, please.
I have a simple but difficult question for our guest, and so I was just curious, given the importance of your study here and the resulting backlash against your family in China, would you make the same decision? And if so, would you make it any differently?
我有一个简单的，但是可能比较难回答的问题。看来您出来以后，你的家人所受到的对待，这种现状，如果能回到你还没出来的时候再做决定的话，你会不会再做同样的决定？
我没大明白什么意思，为什么说？他的意思是说，你现在决定离开山东，离开中国，但是你的在还在山东的家属，是受到了一种不公正的对待。当你离开的时候，你当然不知道他们，因为你走了可能会遇到这样的对待。你如果能回到那个时候，回到那个地方。 你会不会做同样的决定，离开山东，离开中国？其实我们就是来解决难题的。Well,
we're here to resolve difficult questions.
我想，我在没有离开山东之前，我家人的处境并不比现在好。Before
I left Shandong, the situation for my family wasn't any better than it is now.
那个时候，中国为了控制我和我一家所投入的金钱，可能比现在要多得多。At
that time, the money that the government was spending to control me and to control my family was much, much more than it is now.
所以说呢，出来是对的。So
it was the right thing to do to leave.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Ken Chen from Shanghai, China, and I'm also astonished by your stories. And as I recall from your lecture, you mentioned a lot of times about local government and its officers. So it kind of seems to me it's just a maltreatment to you from the local government. So I want to ask you that from your perspective, how much do you think the central government is relevant to your situation or irrelevant to your situation? And what do you think the central government should have done to you?
Thanks. Please translate yourself.
OK, 我叫陈肯，我来自中国上海。我也被你的那个故事震惊。然后你在你的演讲当中多次提到了当地政府和当地政府官员，所以对于我这样一个局外人来看的话，我们可能会认为这更多的是一个当地政府对你的不公正的对待。那么，所以我想问的是，从你的角度来看，这个中央政府对于你的情况有多大的关联，或者是他们完全想置之事外，以及你认为有哪些事情是中央政府应该做而没有做的？谢谢。
嗯，好。我提到的地方政府，就是说，至少他们是一个执行者。
When I talk about the local officials, I can say they're the ones who carried things out.
我们大家都看得到，这是他们做的。
This is what we could see because we saw what they did.
至于是谁指使他们做的，需要咱们去调查，拿到证据以后，我们可以确认。
As to who directed them to do what they did, we would need evidence. After we were able to do an investigation, we would need to do an investigation and find out what the evidence is.To show who are the ones who were actually directing them to do what they did.
如果说以前中央政府不知道的话，我相信现在中央政府是100%的知道了。
I would say that even if the central government didn't know before, I would say with 100% certainty that they know now.
那么现在他们以前给我做出的承诺，要对山东展开彻底调查，做出公开处理的这个承诺，到现在还没有兑现。
The promise they gave me was that they would do a complete and thorough investigation of the conduct of the Shandong authorities, and that it would be a transparent investigation. Fair investigation, but up until now, there's still been no investigation.
我在给温家宝的视频里也提到，如果中央政府对这种数年来的这种惨无人道的违法行为展开调查，做出彻底处理的话，这个事实就能证明可能是地方政府所为。即使是中央有人暗中指使，他也不代表官方。但如果不调查，就等于用事实告诉全世界，这一切见不得人的事情都是中央指使干的。
Just as in the message I sent to Premier Wen Jiabao, I said that if an investigation uncovered the facts and showed that only local officials were responsible, then they could be held responsible. And if the investigation showed that certain central government officials were responsible, it would show that those particular individuals were responsible. But if there's no investigation, then the conclusion must be that the central government is responsible.
我想大家就可以根据这个结果来判断究竟是地方所为还是中央所为。
So I think everybody can draw their own conclusions, whether it's the local government's responsibility or the central government's responsibility.
You see, you raise a key question.I wanted to deprive the Chinese government of this excuse. In 2005, I wrote an article in the Far Eastern Economic Review asking Zhou Yongkang, the head of the party political legal system, the minister then of public security, is this the way you want your government to be known in the world? I wanted to make it clear and to others.What was happening down in Dongshigu and Henan County. They haven't got that excuse. It's a very complicated situation. On the one hand, the central government promulgates the very strict birth control norms. On the other hand, they promulgate the criminal procedure norms. And the local officials are under conflicting pressures. But the central government knows how they resolve their pressures withvery unlawful behavior, which he objected to. 我给他们介绍我零五年写的文章，在这个远东经济杂志介绍周永康。我不要他用这个借口，我们不知道这个董事局的官员干什么。Yeah, good. Please, next, and then we'll have you.
Hi, my question is about the applicability of international legal human rights norms, as well as the further development of.The Chinese legal system using the West as a model. There's been a long-standing discussion that Asian legal values are somehow inconsistent with Western legal norms, and I'm wondering what Mr. Chen's opinion is on that.
虽然我可以说中文，但是因为我太不好意思了，我不要用中文来提我的问题。谢谢。我也不好意思。他的问题是，你认为国际法，尤其是国际人权法，在中国能够起个什么作用？因为。 多年来有这么一个学术的辩论，就是人权的价值是不是共同的，还是亚洲是不是有一些特殊的价值观点？我想只要他叫人，人权价值就应该起作用。
I think as long as there are people, as long as there are humans, then human rights should apply.
当然，人权不可能对物权起作用。 那么我想说人权对他不能起作用的，他不会承认自己是一个物品吧？Of
course, human rights can't apply to things. They only apply to people. So if you say something is a thing, then that thing doesn't have human rights.
现在的问题是，我个人觉得，国际法，特别是人权法，对这些独裁国家目前不能发挥作用。I
think the problem now is that. Human rights law, especially as far as dictatorships are concerned, really cannot have any effect.
所以当权者可以一方面否认这个事实的存在，一方面拒绝国际媒体和善良的人士去认定事实。
So those in power can, on the one hand, deny that these facts exist, and on the other hand, refuse to allow foreign media or people of goodwill to look into the matters and investigate and report on them.
所以东石谷连蝙蝠侠都飞不进去。东石谷？对。还有哪？东石谷就是一个东西，蝙蝠侠就是那个贝尔。
Oh, Batman. Sorry. So even Batman was not able to enter 东石谷.
That's right. Very good.
另一个，是好的，OK.
You see, he likes to joke too, despite everything, and that was essential. 历史文开玩笑非常重要. Please, yes, Miss.
Hello, it's my pleasure to be here. My name is Yang Jiahui. I'm from Guangzhou, and I'm studying NYU now. I'm interested in why Chinese government will allow Mr. Chen Yu to be to come into U.S. because a lot of us know that you have suffered a lot under the government. So the reason why the government will allow you to come to the U.S. is a really curious problem for me. Is that some political pressure put by the U.S. or is it just a Chinese government's free will to allow you to be here? And the second question is, sorry, the second question
about
is
about one question at a time. But you're going to do your own translation.
Okay. Yeah. 陈先生你好，我非常荣幸的能够见到您一面，因为之前在国内的报道听了很多关于你的事情，然后我非常感兴趣的一件事情就是为什么中国政府会允许你来到美国，因为在中国的这么多年，你经历了很多挫折和压迫，然后而且我认为在中国政府的角度来说，这应该算是一个。 家丑不可外扬的事情，他们为什么还会允许你来到美国接受学习？然后他们是以一个怎样的途径，一个很正常的法律，一个很正常的途径，让你出来，还是受到一些美国这边的政治压力，所以才能够让你出来的？谢谢。我觉得家丑不可外扬，中国的法律里没有这样写。
I feel that the concept of don't airing dirty laundry is not in the Chinese law.
这只是封建社会的一个标准。
This is a standard that comes from feudal society.
中国现在是封建末年, 向公民社会转型的时刻了, 这种原则不适用。
China is now transitioning from a feudal society to a civil society, and this kind of concept really has no place.
我之所以能到美国来, 我就用简单的一句话来回答, 就是因为大家正义的力量起了作用。
How is it that I was able to come to the United States? I would just say it very simply that the struggle of many people was able to make a difference.
其中也包括你的关注。
And including your own observation.
所以我们每个人都应该看得起我们自己的努力，我们每个人自己的努力都会对这个社会向好的方向发展起到非常重要的作用。当然，每一个集体。 每一个组织、每一个党派、每一个国家都是这样的。如果我们每一个人对这种违法犯罪者都非常害怕他们的话，都担心他们要不要生气的话，那我们真的是堪忧了，我们的人权价值。
What I can say is that we each ought to respect our own power. We each ought to respect our ability to make a difference. Doesn't matter what organization you're in or what country you're in, if you're afraid of people who abuse power, then nothing will ever change. We need to respect our own power to make a difference.
If you're interested in the details, get a copy of the new magazine.
Okay, thank
you very much. NYU Alumni Magazine, because it has some details about how he got out. And he got out in the end because the Chinese government, after bitter experience trying to cope with him, decided it was just too much trouble. Get rid of him. Get him out of the country.
Well, if I could step out of my role as interpreter for a minute.
Please.
Professor Cohen is very modest. He played an extremely important role in this process. And Mr. Chen just said an individual can make a difference. And in this case, many individuals made a difference. But Jerry made a huge difference. And really helped both countries resolve a difficult situation. And as you said, the details are available in this article and elsewhere. But I think it bears mentioning, if there's one or two people in the room who don't know, that Jerry made a huge difference in this process and was a benefit for both China and the United States.
You see why we hired Ira. He's also going to, he's also going to be our propaganda chief. Xuanchuan Buja. Okay, we're running out of time now. We have 15 minutes, please.
Hello, I'm from University of Connecticut. And I just think you just mentioned the dysfunction of a legal system in China. But in my opinion, I think it's a problem of, it's not a problem of laws, it's a problem of politics. And we see the endeavor of some lawyers or law workers, their endeavors are so powerless. And so do you think, as I'm not a law student, and do you think what ordinary students or ordinary people can do apart from laws? Because, you know, even reformist leaders, they can have a great influence on the reform of China. 我是来自康州大学的学生，我想问的就是说，程先生刚刚提到了中国法治的不健全和它的失效，我就想说，我觉得这不单是一个法律的问题，这是这完全就是一个政治的问题。您可以看到，在国内一些法律工作者，他们的一些努力完全是根本，我觉得就是微不足道的，然后。 Their words are regarded as nonsense. 没有人听他们的话。然后我就问，是不是要从政治或者其他方面来解决这个问题？我不是一个法律的学生，我就想向我们这些其他人可以做些什么。
其实决定中国未来的不是说当权者想怎么样或者不想怎么样。
In reality, the future of China is not going to be decided by those in power who decide whether it's going to be like this or like that.
每一个普普通通的中国人，他的觉醒程度，他的权利意识，他的法治意识，他的社会责任，他对要求社会公正的强烈程度，决定着中国的未来。
In fact, it's really every ordinary person, their determination, their consciousness of their rights, their knowledge of the law, their sense of social responsibility, those are the things that are going to determine the direction of China.
请你相信呢，任何我们的一点一滴的努力都不会白费，在中国将来转型的过程中或者转型的关键时刻都会起到重要的决定性作用。
Please believe that every effort, every effort that each person makes is not going to be wasted. Everything you do will make a difference.
哪一个中国的皇帝不是想千秋万代呢？可是他最后能吗？
Every emperor of China wanted to live forever, and wanted their dynasty to last forever. But history shows that that wasn't the case.
所以应该相信民众的力量。我们也看到这几年民众觉醒非常快。那么你也应该相信你的力量会比我大得多。
So we should believe in the power of the people. And your power is much greater than mine.
Okay, now we have a problem. We have 10 minutes to go, and I see 8 people who want to ask questions. So what I would like to do is ask each of you 8 to, in one sentence, give us your question. And then we'll ask Mr. Chen to try to respond briefly. That's the best we
okay,
can do.
Okay.
Quiet.
My question is a simple one. How do you compare yourself with the Nobel Peace Prize winner, Mr. Liu Xiaobo?
Okay, come on.
Seems like your reform proposal is more moderate with, than him, and you have no problem with communist rule itself. Okay. Well, 你好，陈先生，我是三年级的 NYU 学生，我也是来自中国山东。
哦，你好，老乡。
你好。我的问题是，你怎么看待诺贝尔和平奖得主刘晓波先生啊？还有最重要的就是你怎么对比你和他？
我还没有回答以前，我要听别人的问题，你总可以总结。
哦，好的。
Yeah, okay. Yes, please.
Okay, Mr. Liu, my question is a little bit personal. So my question is, will you ever return to China after you receive your degree here? Because you're currently not under asylum status, or will you just stay in the United States for the rest of your life? And what is your career plan for fighting for Chinese civil rights in the future? Thank you.
你用中文吧。
哦，可以。就是陈先生，那么你拿到了你的学位以后，你会不会再回到中国，还是你会留在美国，或者像你刚刚说的去台湾？还有就是你不论你的答案是什么，那么你以后是准备如何去就是为中国争取民权？这是我的问题，谢谢。
Okay.
总的来说呢，
快
像刘晓波呢，我觉得是全世界还被关押在监狱里的唯一一个诺贝尔和平奖得主。我想我跟他如果说一定相比的话，我们都坐过牢。
Well, as for Mr. 刘晓波, he's the only Nobel laureate in prison.When you ask me to compare myself to him, well, I can say we both spent time in prison.
我想这个刚才这位朋友提到的这个建议呢，就是说中国我相信将来肯定不会永远是这个样子，那么我回到中国只是一个时间问题，不管是在什么地方，只要能为人类的人权问题去努力去推动，我都会继续做。可能方法很多。
Okay.
To answer this question, China will not always be this way in the future. So my return to China is just a matter of time. And I believe that no matter where I am, I can make a difference.
Good. Please.
My question is, based on my understanding, U.S. is based on a common law system, whereas China is based on a civil law system. So my question is, do you think it's better for China to change its law system and adopt the U.S. common law system? And if yes, is that even possible? 我的问题就是说，现在美国是用那个普通法。 然后中国呢是用那个民法，所以我问题是，欧洲大陆的。哦，yeah，and，你觉得说，中国有可能就是，你觉得说，中国会不会更好，就是用那个中美国的那个普通法的那个法治，and then，你觉得有可能吗？
OK，还有一个问题。一切皆有可能。Everything
is possible.
Mr. Chen, you mentioned that a change in China is inevitable. Can I just ask, where do you foresee this change coming from? From the masses, from the intellectuals, or from the party itself? 陈先生，你刚才谈到改变在中国是大势所趋的。那我请问你一下，你认为这个改变是从何而来？从普及大众，还是从知识分子，还是从党本身？我想。
刚才我已经说得很清楚了，普通大众权利意识的觉醒是决定中国未来的最重要的基础。So
I think I've already said it before, very clearly, that the future of China will be determined by the determination of ordinary people.
当然也需要很多人的参与关注，知识分子和普通大众本身没有什么界限，普通大众当中也有很多知识分子。当然，国际社会的关注也非常重要。And
of course, they will need a lot of help. In China, there's really no gap between the intellectuals and the ordinary people. Many intellectuals come from the ordinary people.
没有足够的压力，党不会改变的。
And of course, the international observation and international assistance would also be very helpful. Without the world watching, nothing will change.
Quick, please.
Thank you for speaking to us today. You've highlighted many of the gross injustices that you faced in China. And the problems that its rule of law has. You've also said change is inevitable. When that change happens, what do you hope to see preserved? And I can't translate.
Did you say you can or? Oh, no. Okay. 非常感谢今天来跟我们对话。今天你提到中国很你自己经历的很多不公正的事，还有中国的很多问题，还有这个中国的这个 不可避免改变。你的希望是中国经过改变以后还会保留什么？保留传统的善良文化。The traditional good culture of China.
借鉴现代的文明。
To borrow from modern civilization.
谢谢.
Thank you.
Okay, last question here. Well, I'll try to get, well, let's please, quiet. Let's see.
Yeah, hello, Mr. Chen. I am a graduate student in NYU studying international relations. And I have, and firstly, I want to make a refutation about a former statement of you that Chinese central government is relevant to your problem. But do you think it is a more cultural problem rather than a political problem? Because no matter who is the leader of China, because of the feudal authoritarian tradition, he will stay choose the same choice to deal with your problem. And my second...
No. Yeah. Come on. Translate it.
Yeah.
We only have 2 minutes and you want two okay. questions.
你好，陈先生，我是一个来自纽约大学的研究生，学习国际关系。我首先想做对你刚才一个言论做一个反驳，就是，你刚才提到说，中国中央政府是，明知你的问题而不闻不问，或甚至指使地方政府对你的问题就是进行，对您进行不正当的对待，但是我认为这是不是？ 这是不是一个文化上的问题，而不仅仅是一个政治上的问题？因为，
因为中国有很强烈的就是封建独裁的传统，不管谁做中国的领导人，他们可能都会做同样一个选择，就是对您这个问题。
嗯，您觉得蒋经国的选择和他们一样吗？
对。
Did you feel that?
所以我所以我有第二个问题。
Let me translate.
Yeah.
Do you feel that the choice made by Jiang Jingguo,
so
who was the president of Taiwan, the son of Chiang Kai-shek?
Yes.
Was the same choice.
So I want to ask my second question.
I think you will ask it after the program closes. Thank you very much. Our time is up. I'm so happy this happened. This was an event we could not have envisaged even 6 months ago. And I'm so happy to have this terrific public participation of people not only from the law school or NYU, but elsewhere. And so many from China who are willing to speak up and take part. And quite a number of you who, although not from China, have spoken Chinese very well. So I think the future of U.S.-China relations today looks more optimistic to me than it did yesterday. But we hope we'll hear from Mr. Chen a number of times during the year. And he'll be here until the end of the academic year. And I want to thank him for doing so well today. And I want to thank my dear colleague, Ira Belkin, for the extremely difficult task which he carried out so well of being interpreter. So let's continue. We're going to be working here all academic year. We've got a whole range of activities, and we hope to get acquainted with many of you. Fei Chang Gan Shi.
谢谢大家。